Does rosemary oil work for hair loss? What does the science say? It's actually so much worse than what I had in my first video, and these are some massive issues with scientific studies that we need to look out for with hair growth treatments and science-backed things in general, and people don't really talk much about them. I'm Michelle, my PhD was in medicinal chemistry. I've been looking into the science behind beauty products for 13 years, so I have seen a lot of scientific scamminess. But the stuff I've seen for rosemary oil is next level. A little while back, I did this video looking at the study that doctors and scientists are using to say there's good scientific evidence for rosemary oil helping with hair loss.
It's a really great natural alternative to minoxidil.
Here's the research. You can use rosemary oil and it will stimulate your hair growth.
That's slowed down a lot on social media since then, although it hasn't stopped entirely, and experts, including dermatologists and cosmetic chemists, are still citing the study in magazines, a lot of which seem to love hyping up whatever ingredient is trending. And I guess the sales commissions don't hurt. If you haven't seen my first video, I would recommend watching that first, because today I'm going to be expanding on some of the extra dodginess that I found around rosemary oil, and these dodgy issues are not limited to rosemary oil. A quick recap, this 2015 study was already pretty bad. It looks like most of the doctors and scientists only read the abstract, which says there was no significant difference between rosemary oil and minoxidil. That sounds really good, but abstracts are short summaries that leave out a lot of important information. They often hype up the study a bit too much, so you need to read the actual study to work out if it's legit. Yes, the study is peer-reviewed, but all that peer-review really means is that about 3 or 4 scientists who aren't paid and are probably overworked, they read over the study and said that it looked good. How robust this process is really variable. It's usually not super great for a small journal that seems to be published by a marketing and communications company. Oh no. It's got one of these things. Sheesh. Anyway, this study is not good on multiple levels. If you believe the results, it only shows a tiny increase in hair. Minoxidil didn't work very well in the study, possibly because a low percentage was used, also possibly because 6 months is too short a period of time. So rosemary oil being not significantly different from it is not really anything spectacular. But there are a lot of reasons not to believe the results. This paper is just full of basic mistakes that make it seem like it was written by ChatGPT. For example, these results that shouldn't have been the same were the same. This mistake carried through to their graphs. They also can't do basic maths. A bunch of the averages and percentages were calculated incorrectly. A whole bunch of their references pointed to the wrong graph. This bit was especially ChatGPT-ish. They say they used the Hamilton rating scale for depression to measure hair coverage instead of the Norwood Hamilton scale for male pattern hair loss. The reason ChatGPT makes these sorts of mistakes is that it is really good at writing things that sound correct, but it doesn't actually understand any of the science behind it. But the problem here is, this is 2015, ChatGPT wasn't around then. I had a sneaking suspicion about why this might have happened, but I hadn't dug that deeply when I made the first video, and honestly, I had so much to talk about there already. But I have gone deeper down the rabbit hole now, and the thing that really stuck out to me here is that this paper feels like it's from a paper mill or something similar. If you aren't aware, paper mills are a massive problem in science at the moment. I've talked a bit about publish or perish in my video on whether retinol is a scam. We tend to think of research from industry as being less reliable than research from academic institutions like universities and hospitals, because in industry there is a financial conflict of interest. But a huge problem with independent academic research is this culture of publish or perish. Basically, the more peer-reviewed papers you publish, the more you get promoted, the more research funding you get. If you don't publish enough, well, you lose your job. But not all research has an equal chance of getting published. If you found that something didn't work, so if rosemary oil didn't work as well as minoxidil, for example, it is less likely to get published. This is called publication bias, and this is a problem because these negative results are also useful to know. But journals have limited space. They are going to publish research that seems more important and more exciting. So if you spent a whole bunch of time and money on a study, your team has spent over a year just counting the hairs on 100 different people's heads, at the end of all that, if there wasn't a good result, that is going to be pretty disappointing. There is a lot of temptation to just fake your results. And of course, this isn't ethical. It is scientific fraud. It pollutes the body of evidence. It misleads people into making bad decisions. But because of all these incentives, this does happen. But at some point, some big brains realized, if you are going to just fake your results anyway, why not save all the time and money and just not do the study properly in the first place? Or why not even just make up the results completely? But then some bigger brains realized that was also a waste of time and money. Why do the writing and faking yourself? Everyone is so specialized these days. Why not set up a whole business that just pumps out these low-quality papers with partly or completely faked results? There are so many scientists and doctors who need to keep publishing papers to get promotions. They might not have time to conduct good research. Why not charge them a little fee to just stick their names on these mass-produced papers that they didn't actually work on? And that is how you get a paper mill. There are a lot of red flags with papers from paper mills. They tend to have the same style of writing. They cite the same papers. They have reused images. They are often published in special issues where the guest editor might be paid off to just not look at the papers too closely. And most importantly, they don't make scientific sense if you know a bit about the topic. A lot of journals are also just not that discerning when it comes to rejecting papers. Researchers pay to publish the papers. It is a massive income stream for them. There is a lot of work being done by volunteer sleuths to expose these paper mills and try to get these misleading studies retracted. The most famous person in this area is probably Elizabeth Bick, who is an absolute queen. Her website, Retraction Watch, and For Better Science are great places to learn more about this sort of dodgy science. They are where I mostly learned about this, as well as the scientists on Twitter. Rest in piss. P. Judo also has this great video. Now, back to rosemary oil. This study, in my opinion, has a lot of strong signs of being from a paper mill or at least partly fabricated by someone similar who just doesn't really know much about the science. First, there's the fact that this paper seems like it's written by someone who knows roughly how a paper should sound and look. Well, maybe they are a bit new at this. These 3D graphs are pretty cringe. But they don't know much about the actual topic of hair loss. That's what's giving that ChatGPT vibe. The style is there, but the substance, not so much. There were all these basic mistakes, of course, but the thing that really stuck out to me was this Hamilton scale for depression error. You do not need to be a hair loss researcher to realize that this Hamilton scale for depression is not the right name. These four authors supposedly spent at least a year, most likely multiple years, applying for grants and ethics approval and then working on this study, which involved this scale. One of them supposedly wrote it, and then all four of them had to sign off on it, but none of them spotted this. On the other hand, if you're someone who writes a lot of papers that you don't have any idea about, you might not be paying quite as much attention. And then there's the authors. First off, there are particular countries where paper mills are more active: China, India, Russia, and the country where this study was supposedly done, Iran. Now, not all researchers from these countries are using paper mills. In fact, there are honest scientists from these countries who hate paper mills because it is ruining their credibility and making a mockery out of their hard work. China has actually taken steps to get research institutions to stop promoting or hiring researchers just based on their number of papers. But it is a signal that this country probably has an incentive structure that rewards this kind of thing really well, and it does seem to be valid in this case. The corresponding author, Amir Hussein Sahebka, I'm sorry if I said your name wrong, his research record is really impressive. A bit too impressive. He has 278 papers listed on his Google Scholar record with a publication year of 2023. For 2022, he had 267. But that was when he was actually slacking off. In 2021, he had 367. That is just over one paper a day, including weekends. This is just not really a believable level of research output. Some people call these hyper-prolific researchers. I know I really need to change the battery in that light. It depends on the field, but most scientists publish maybe 10 papers a year. You need to have contributed substantially to the work to be counted as an author. All of his time would be spent reading the papers and just communicating with other authors. He wouldn't have any time to conduct the actual research for the 250-ish papers he would publish the next year, let alone apply for grants and ethics approvals and come up with new research ideas or maybe teach if his uni makes him do that. For those of you worrying about whether he is slowing down as he gets older, it's okay. He is on track to get over 400 papers for 2024. As a comparison, the most hyper-prolific researcher in Spain only published 176 papers in 2022. Maybe I'm being too harsh, maybe he is just incredibly efficient with his time, but he also has a pretty impressive retraction record, 7 papers so far. Retractions are when a journal decides that the problems with your paper are so bad you can't just correct them. The entire contribution of that paper to the scientific body of evidence is put into question. They put out an official notification to withdraw it. It looks like this, and it is usually because there are clear signs of fraud. It is pretty embarrassing. It means that either you did the fraud or you didn't notice that your co-workers were doing the fraud. It generally takes a lot for a journal to retract a paper, and it is slow. The Wakefield Vaccines Autism Study wasn't retracted for 12 years. So having 7 papers retracted is a lot. And most of these were retracted during an investigation that the publisher was doing into paper mills. They retracted thousands of other paper mill papers at the same time. So it seems like this guy is probably into paper mills, and if that's true, then I'm sure there are more retractions in the pipeline, so I would just be really cautious with any of his papers. In general, I would recommend checking for critiques of any study or author, such as on PubPeer, before trusting it. There's another big red flag in the topics of these retracted papers, as well as publishing papers at maybe 20, 50, 100 times the rate of a standard medical researcher. He is also somehow an expert on a really wide range of topics. This might all just look very medicine-y, but by the time you're publishing scientific research, you are really specialized. His specialties seem to be pharmaceutical biotechnology and cardiovascular research, so looking at this, it is a bit weird for him to be publishing on lung cancer and vaccines and wound healing and bladder cancer and hair loss. The other researchers also don't specialize in hair loss. Takhizade, the second author, again, I am sorry if I mispronounced that, he is mostly in nutrition and he is a fair bit less industrious. He only publishes about 10 papers a year, which honestly is kind of disappointing. Please do better. He's also a lot less hyper-prolific with the retractions. He's only got 5, which is a lot for a regular researcher. I mean, even 1 is a lot. It makes for really awkward conversations at conferences. His ones are from publishing with a research group that has this 116-page report that is dedicated to the many, many issues in their many, many papers, which include astonishingly and implausibly prolific research activity and impossible data. The other two researchers are honestly just a letdown. The first guy is in critical care, he only has 1 retraction, but he's got quite a few sus PubPeer entries. The third guy, who was doing mostly reproductive research at the time, he doesn't actually have any. Science is collaborative, so you do have authors who are working in multiple fields before they start specializing, or they might just help out with a specific part of someone else's paper. But you would expect some of the authors to specialize in hair or dermatology. This is just really sus, and 13 retractions between the 4 of them is also really impressively sus. Clearly, these authors are pretty well versed in dodgy research. Although all of this should have been enough for massive alarm bells. Now, since I posted that first Rosemary Oil video, I have had lots of comments saying, hey, that's not the only study, what about all of the others? It is true that replication, which is when lots of groups are getting results that support the same claim, that is a good way of overcoming problems with dodgy studies, but a lot of the studies that people are citing don't actually support the same claim. I talked about this last time. There are a few other studies with rosemary oil, but they mostly use mixtures where rosemary oil is just one of the components, so it doesn't really tell us much about rosemary oil specifically. This is about looking at what the independent variable is. What are the researchers actually changing between the groups? If you're using multiple things like a mixture of different oils or rosemary oil in combination with something else like electromagnetic pulses, you can't tell if it's actually the rosemary oil working or if it's one of those other things. And this is assuming the studies are good. A lot of these studies also have a whole bunch of red flags. Some of these studies don't have a proper comparison, they're not really changing one variable, they are just testing one thing on a group of people without any control group. This is a problem because you need a point of comparison. Hair count will naturally fluctuate throughout the year, we generally have a bit more hair in spring. Some types of hair loss also reverse after some time on their own. That means you can't say rosemary oil or whatever treatment you're looking at actually increase hair growth without also seeing what happened to other people who didn't use it. They just used water, for example. The hair might have come back anyway, even if you didn't do anything. This is also something that a lot of brands take advantage of when they're showing before and after photos in their ads, not just for hair loss, but also for things like pimples and dark spots. Telogen effluvium, which is when you lose a whole bunch of hair really suddenly because of stress or sickness. That one naturally reverses after a while, so a lot of treatments that people are trying for this will look like that they are working, even if they aren't. Some of the comments actually told me that I missed the study shown here, so maybe check this first before typing out a really long comment. Maybe with all of that extra time, we can also publish 300 studies a year. There are also a whole bunch of review articles out there like these ones from the last video. These aren't evidence themselves, they are basically summaries of the evidence, and a lot of the time, they're not trying very hard. A lot of them are just repeating what that dodgy 2015 study said. Again, just because it's peer-reviewed doesn't mean it's good. Now, there are also some animal studies on rosemary oil, and I didn't look too much at these in the first video because mice and rats aren't humans. Most things that work in animal studies don't end up working in humans. But I did read through one of these studies a little while back because I was procrastinating on something else, and strap in. This study tested 2% minoxidil against a hair lotion with 1% rosemary. Each one was tested on 6 mice, and there was also another 6 mice in a control group. This is a pretty small sample size, which is a problem, but there are more problems. It also looks like maybe they didn't get the results they wanted, in my opinion. Here are some of the images. The first one is skin that's from a mouse treated with water, the second one is from rosemary oil, and the third one got minoxidil. Can you see anything funny here? I'll give you a little bit of time to just stare at the dots, try not to stare too hard and freak yourself out. These two on the right are way too similar. So in biology, when you have microscope images like these, they should be pretty unique. These two are meant to be from different mice. But if you have a look at both of them, you can see that there's like 5 spots in a little M shape on the left, ignore that black arrow, and then they have 3 dark spots in a row, which is followed by a lighter one that's a bit bigger. These patterns should not be this similar if they're from different mice or even different parts of the same mouse. These really look like they're just 2 photos of the same skin sample. Here are some more images, and if you want to look for the duplicates yourself, you can pause this here. I found these ones. You can see how similar the shapes of these fingery things are, and while I was putting this video together, I think I found another 2. These ones are a bit more squished, but they have like a red squiggle and then a bunch of stripes. There are also some really sus photos of the mice. If you don't want to look at photos of shaved mice, please skip ahead to the time shown here on the screen. Are you ready? Are you sure? Time for some shaved mice. Again, columns A, B, and C are meant to be water, rosemary, and minoxidil, so these are meant to be separate groups of mice. Can you see the problem? Here are the problems. The top 2 are the same mice. This is what B looks like if you stretch him out a little bit and mess around with the contrast. These 2 are also the same mouse from slightly different angles. This is what they look like next to each other with a little bit of stretching. You can see how that dark patch on their back is exactly the same. There are also some really sus numbers in their results tables, and in my opinion, there is just way too much sus stuff in this paper for all of these to just be honest mistakes. I mean, rosemary oil could work, but there isn't really any good scientific evidence that it does, which just puts it back at the level of every other non-science-backed hair loss treatment. And all of this dodginess surrounding the main 2 rosemary studies that everyone is citing really suggests that it didn't actually work in these studies, but the authors really wanted it to look like it did. These authors did publish a 2013 review about how great rosemary is, so they had to do a little bit of tweaking to get the results they wanted. If it worked, they wouldn't have had to do this. I know that it sucks to hear that something that seems like a good science-backed option isn't actually science-backed, and that there are a lot of signals that it probably doesn't work. But rosemary oil does have risks. I know that a lot of people think there's no harm in trying natural remedies, so why not try it anyway? I went through some of the risks in my last video, but I really wanted to highlight this. Male and female pattern hair loss, which are 2 of the most common reasons for hair loss, they are progressive. The more you delay treating it, the further along it is before you finally stop it from getting worse. There are also conditions like scarring alopecia, and that scarring is a permanent loss of those hair follicles. I got a lot of comments saying this last time, so just to save time, I'm going to reply with a squid emoji. Look, Sahebka made me really feel like an underachiever. I really need to get more work done and make my parents proud. Please don't tell them about him. And I know some of you are itching to comment that it worked for you. I talked about that in the previous video too. If you like using it, then fine. I'm not saying you need to stop, but that is not good evidence that it works for a lot of reasons that I covered last time, as well as in this other video on anecdotal evidence. I am going to reply to those comments with a zebra. And all of these issues with anecdotal evidence and trying out unproven treatments also apply more generally to other areas of science and health, as well as other types of skin and hair care issues too. There is a lot of questionable science-based advice out there, even on things that seem really obvious, like drying your hair. This video has more on that topic. I also have a chapter in my book on hair. For more myth-busting, check out this playlist.